As we celebrate the 15th Sunday in Ordinary Time, let's all stand and join in singing our gathering song, number 590, Christ Be Our Light, number 590.
Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. You are sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Thanks for your great glory, Lord.
O God, who show the light of your truth to those who go astray, so that they may return to the right path, give all who for the faith they profess are accounted Christians the grace to reject whatever is contrary to the name of Christ, and to strive after all that does it honor. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Amos. Amaziah, priest of Bethel, said to Amos, "Off with you, visionary, flee to the land of Judah. There earn your bread by prophesying, but never again prophesy in Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary and a royal temple." Amos answered Amaziah, "I was no prophet, nor have I belonged to a company of prophets. I was a shepherd and a dresser of sycamores. The Lord took me from following the flock and said to me, 'Go, prophesy to my people Israel.'" The word of the Lord.
Salvation is near for those who fear him, and his glory will dwell in our land. Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation. Merciful love and faithfulness have met, justice and peace have kissed. Faithfulness shall spring from the earth, and justice look down from heaven. Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation. Also the Lord will bestow his bounty, and our earth shall yield its increase. Justice will march before him and guide his steps on the way. Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavens, as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world to be holy and without blemish before him. In love, he destined us for adoption to himself through Jesus Christ, in accord with the favor of his will, for the praise of the glory of his grace that he granted us in the beloved. In him, we have redemption by his blood, the forgiveness of transgressions, in accord with the riches of his grace that he lavished upon us. In all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will in accord with his favor that he set forth in him as a plan for the fullness of times to sum up all things in Christ, in heaven and on earth. In him, we were also chosen, destined in accord with the purpose of the one who accomplishes all things according to the intention of his will, so that we might exist for the praise of his glory, we who first hoped in Christ. In him, you also, who have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and have believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, which is the first installment of our inheritance toward redemption as God's possession to the praise of his glory. The word of the Lord.
From the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus summoned the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He instructed them to take nothing for the journey but a walking stick, no food, no sack, no money in their belts. They were, however, to wear sandals, but not a second tunic. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave. Whatever place does not welcome you or listen to you, leave there and shake the dust off your feet in testimony against them." So they went off and preached repentance. The 12 drove out many demons, and they anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. To whomever left me the anonymous note while I was over praying before Mass, first, I love you very much. Second, anonymous notes are not kind or charitable. And lastly, as a priest, I take praying and preparing for homilies very serious. It's part of our call that we are ordained to do, to teach, to prophesize as the prophet Amos. And I take it very seriously. And I know I'm not a perfect preacher. I'm always working on further developing and improving myself. However, as part of that call that I take seriously in spending that time in prayer is to preach the truth, to preach not the homilies that people want to hear, but the homilies that the Lord feels they need to hear, to respond generously to the Lord's call for me to preach, to challenge you, to make you uncomfortable so you may go deeper in your conversion and union with the Lord. I wouldn't love you if I only gave you the homilies that you wanted to hear in the way that you wanted to hear them. I love you too much to do that. And so I'm going to respond to the Lord's call and respond to the preparation and give the homilies that you need, not the homilies that you want. Now I am, of course, always open to constructive criticism, and I've probably already thought the things that you're willing to criticize, as I'm my own worst critic, and often my walk back to the chair where I sit, I'm listing all the things that I thought I did wrong in my homily, because that's just how my brain works. So I'm totally open to constructive criticism. But I love you all. I love whoever left that note, and that's all that we will say. And now we're gonna dive into the famous, that was an accidental slip of words. I was about to say famous Amos. That's, okay, let's go into the incredible Amos, the prophet, because I think sometimes because of the distance of time, we don't capture how absolutely incredible Amos was as a prophet, and how absolutely courageous he was as a prophet, because he had no formal training. A lot of the prophets back in the day, they were part of these prophet guilds, and they were professional prophets, and which is why when this priest in the king's sanctuary in Bethel says, go back and be a seer in your own land, go back there and receive your nourishment there, he's saying, go back to the kingdom of Judah, go back to the southern kingdom and prophesy, so that way you may earn your income there. But then Amos shockingly responds, I have no training. This is not my formal job, because I am a shepherd and a dresser of sycamores. I spend my time with sheep and trees. I'm not a famous orator. I don't know what I'm doing. All I know is that the Lord drew me out of the southern kingdom, out of my comfort of living in the kingdom of Judah, to come to the north, to risk my life in total humility and obedience to the Lord and proclaim the truth to people who need to hear it. Not out of a sense of pride, but out of a place of humility, of knowing that he was not a skilled orator. He was not a trained prophet. He was not adequate or trained for this position because he spends most of his time with sheep and trees. But the Lord still called, and he went in humility and self-reliance, a reliance on the Lord, not on himself, not on his gifts, not on his talents, and he just went and trusted that the Lord would work through him, because the Lord was calling him to go to the northern kingdom, where he very much could have ended dead, because he was totally challenging their worship of false prophets and other horrific things that they were doing in the northern kingdom at the time. And what a beautiful example for us to truly trust in the Lord, and to trust that the Lord will provide, and that the Lord will always be working that conversion of our hearts when we respond to his will with humility and dependence upon him. That is through our relationship within, realizing and seeing our own limitations, our own sinfulness, our own weakness, but still going forth, trusting in the Lord, and seeing where he will lead us and how he will use us to be, as St. Paul says, God's praise and glory, that all may be for his praise and glory, as Amos was for God's praise and glory. But how different was Amos's approach than how so often we frame things in our life? And I catch myself saying some of these things as well in my own life. It's amazing how this thing, these conversations, these thought patterns can slip into so many aspects of our life, where we almost place the responsibility and our sinfulness on other people, or we place our salvation in other things, where it is no longer the conversion of our own heart, of working with a relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ within our own hearts to recognize our sinfulness first and foremost. We blame things on other situations and seek our salvation through earthly means. And what do I mean by this? Well, some examples. First, well, maybe once this stressful situation in my home resolves, I'll finally stop falling into this sin. Or perhaps once this group of people in this political office, whether local, state, or national, or an international leader, once they're removed, we'll have peace, we'll have this utopia. Or once we get this group of people or this person elected, then we'll have our salvation, then we will have peace. or once we solve this social justice issue, or we eliminate this problem, this problematic group from society that is causing this problems for this one group of people who are not being respected and loved and dignified, then we'll have utopia on earth. Then we'll have peace and justice on earth. As if the sin and the responsibility is on society and us to shape society and wait for society to change rather than the starting point of our own hearts. Rather than starting with our own sinfulness as that first and foremost, that we're blaming our sinfulness not on ourselves, but on society. That I'm trapped in my sin until something in my situation changes. Where we're taking away our free will, we're taking away our own self-responsibility. We're taking away our control over our own life in the sense that the Lord is always asking us to draw closer to Him, to move away from our sins, to pick up our cross and follow Him so we may live for God's praise and glory and the salvation of souls. That we may humbly go to our Lord and follow Him, acknowledging our sinfulness and allowing Him to transform us, because it is then from there that the Lord uses us to impact the world. Because only God can save, only God can transform the world, and only perfection will come after the second coming when the Lord comes to make all things new. That is the only time. And so rather than putting the blame and the responsibility on society and other people and all of these other things, let us turn it, as Amos did, on ourselves. Let us walk with humility and acknowledge our own sinfulness, our own limitations, our own weaknesses, and run to the Lord. Because that is also what the apostles did. It is such a beautiful thing when they went out two by two, commissioned to proclaim repentance, to proclaim the kingdom of God, to heal the sick, and to anoint and to drive out demons and anoint those who needed it as well. And I wish we had so many more stories, because I'm sure there was incredible stories of success, but I'm sure they also made plenty of mistakes. That as they were humbly going out, relying on the Lord, relying on the gifts that God gave them through creating them, the gifts that our Lord Jesus Christ gave them through the powers He bestowed upon them, relying on nothing else but those gifts, on who they were, I'm sure they made mistakes. I'm sure they had trouble discerning, should we stay? Or are these people closed off and we need to shake the dust from our feet? I'm sure they also had times where they just went the wrong way, said the wrong thing, offended a person in a small way. And I'm sure they also had so many beautiful stories of the Lord working through them in incredible ways. But they went out without walking stick, or they had a walking stick, but no food, no sack, no money in their belts, and not even a second tunic. Just a walking stick, a tunic, and some sandals. Emphasizing their total reliance and dependence upon the Lord and the gifts that God has given them. And they went out in humility. They went out knowing that they were sinners dependent upon our Lord Jesus Christ to proclaim the good news, to proclaim the kingdom. Not that they were thinking they were going to transform the world, but they knew Jesus, through them, was going to transform souls, was going to heal the sick and cast out demons, and they went out in that humility, just as Amos did. As Amos knew, I'm just a shepherd and a dresser of sycamores. The apostles, they were also not formally trained to be prophets. They were not formally trained to heal the sick. They were not formally trained to proclaim the gospel, but what they did have, both Amos and the apostles, is they knew their Savior, and they knew they needed their Savior, and they trusted their Savior. And so the Lord asks us this day and invites us this day to do the same, to approach Him at this altar with total humility, to empty ourselves and acknowledge our sinfulness and invite Him in so our hearts may be conformed, that we may move away from our sins with great courage, so He may send us out into the world. So that He, through us, may transform the world one soul at a time. That all may be for God's praise and glory and the salvation of souls. That through our humility and taking responsibility for our sins, of seeking the forgiveness of sins in the confessional, and trusting in the gifts that God has bestowed upon us through our vocations, through our creation, that he will work through all of those things to redeem us, to redeem other souls through our love. But it takes that first step, that first courageous step of humbling ourselves, acknowledging our sins, our sinfulness, and going to our Savior in need and trust. Because it is only from that position that our hearts may be conformed. If we approach him with pride, just blaming our sins and no self-responsibility on society and other situations, the Lord can't really get in there. He needs the crack of humility. He needs our vulnerability of humility. We need to know that we depend upon him, we need him, that we are sinners in need of his mercy, of his love, and his peace. So this day, at this altar of sacrifice, let us approach him together as the body of Christ, as a parish family, with humility, knowing together that we are all sinners, and we all need his mercy, and we need each other, so we may be strengthened to receive his mercy and his love, that he may work through us, that he may use our gifts and use them for his praise and glory and the salvation of souls, that we may be his pleasing instruments that he chooses to use with love to transform the world around us. Now let us stand and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible. In trust and confidence, we bring our prayers before God the Father in heaven.
For the church and all her leaders, may the Spirit move mightily to bring healing and peace through God's servants. Let us pray. For the safety of our military, police, and firefighters, let us pray. For Archbishop Dennis Schnur, may he be strengthened and restored to full health, let us pray. For our Westside Catholic family of parishes, may the Holy Spirit increase his gifts in us to move boldly into our new family with confidence, let us pray. For all who are sick or beset by burdens, may God provide resources and people to aid them. Let us pray. For all who have died in the hope of rising again, may they rejoice in the riches of God's presence. Let us pray. For Carol Connect, for whom this Mass is offered, let us pray.
God, our Father, we ask that you hear and answer these prayers in your time and your will, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
number 588, I have loved you, number 588.
Sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Look upon the offerings of the Church, O Lord, as she makes her prayer to you, and grant that when consumed by those who believe, they may bring ever greater holiness through Christ our Lord. Be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you so loved the world that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we had lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim.
But
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world. Together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Dennis, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you, for them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things we may be defended by your protecting help, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us, who through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Remember also, Lord, your servants, who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Number 916, I receive the living God. Number 916. Heart.
is joined to me, the head. I receive the living God. My heart is full of joy. I receive the living God, and my heart is full of
joy. Number 948, at the table of Jesus, number 948.
Having consumed these gifts, we pray, O Lord, that by our participation in this mystery, its saving effects upon us may grow through Christ our Lord. Just first, thank you for everybody who prayed for a fruitful weekend last weekend with the National Eucharistic Procession, all those who were able to join us for some small part or the whole thing. It was incredibly beautiful and blessed, and just a beautiful blessing from the Lord, from the U.S. bishops for having that idea and following through with the four pilgrimages. And so just thank you, everybody, as it was just such a beautiful weekend and such a beautiful opportunity that we had here at our parishes. And with that, I hope everyone has a wonderful weekend. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Number 607, sing a new song. Number 607.